For that beautiful message in song. It's totally in line with what I'd like to share with you this morning. You notice it's not a sermon. It is the church at study. It is because in these past few days, even up to this very moment, we're so busy paying attention to what is happening in the world, in the United States, and to our own busybody, busy nothings. And so we fail to really read the Bible. Notice that? I think you will all agree that you don't find, you say, I don't have time to read the Bible. I'm not going to say that that is okay, but I'll try to make up for it by engaging ourselves in Bible study this morning. And we're looking at this on a long-term basis as God allows us to be more familiar with the Word of God. So that as we open the Bible today, and I'll ask you to whip out your Bibles, and we're going to read together. And for the sake of JR, really the topic I'd like to address, interrupting the series on religious liberty, not that it is unimportant, but we need to go into both the former reign and the latter reign to prepare us for the final crisis. The crisis now, and the crisis yet to come. So I'd like to invite you to turn your Bibles with me to John 1. So it's not going to be difficult to get started. We're going to get started with John chapter 1. And it will begin with verse 18. John chapter 1, verse 18. And I will literally beg you to read the Bible with me. Don't listen to a sermon. Read the Word of God for yourselves. And you will find that as we make progress, you will find how the topic has to be presaged by this reading, because we're here at worship, right? Now, our gathering here today can be in vain if we don't realize that we are in the house of God. The Lord is in this place. Genesis 28, 16 and 17. Hold that reading on the Bible. This is part of it. And Jacob, who became Israel and the father of spiritual Israel today, awake out of his sleep, and I hope we do today. And he said, surely, and you can say that with me, the Lord is in this place, and I knew it not. Can God be here today and we are not aware? Yes, indeed. Until it is brought to our attention. And if we pay close attention, we will find that that's our condition. As Isaiah found out, Isaiah was not always what he was until God showed him who he was. And Jacob, that's Genesis 28, 16 and 17. And Jacob awake out of his sleep and he said, surely the Lord is in this place and I knew it not. And he was afraid. And that's why we're so fearful at times and many a times. And said, how dreadful is this place? Now, if we're not prepared to come into worship, we will be dreadful. We'll find this place dreadful. But if we are, we will find it delightful. And he was afraid and said, how dreadful is this place? This is none other but the house of God, and this is the gates of heaven. Wow. You see, true reverence for God is inspired by a sense of his infinite greatness and a realization of his presence. Two things. His infinite greatness and the realization of his presence here and now. With his sense of the unseen. So feeling is part of that, but it's sanctified feeling. That we can discern the unseen. And every heart should be deeply impressed by this. The hour and place of prayer are sacred because God is there. It's not the prayer itself. It's not the act of prayer, but because God is there. And as reverence is manifested in attitude and demeanor, so it's both internally and externally. The feeling that inspires it, it will be deepened. So feelings are a part of this, friends. Indeed, the psalmist declares in Psalm 111, verse 9, holy and reverend is his name. You know, angels, when they speak that name, they veil their faces. With what reverence then should we, who are fallen and sinful, take it upon our lips? Well would it be for both the old and the young to ponder those words of Scripture that show how the place marked by God's special presence should be regarded. How should we regard it? As in Moses' experience, he heard the words in Exodus 3, verse 5. Put off thy shoes from off thy feet. He commanded Moses at the burning bush. That was a place of worship because the presence of God was there. For he said, for the place whereon thou standest is holy ground. God is high and holy. And to those who are humble and believing, his house on earth, his house on earth, the place where his people meet for worship, wherever that may be, is the gate of heaven. Do you understand that, friends? Well, I hope you realize that. The songs of praise, the words spoken by Christ's appointed ministers and teachers are God's appointed agencies to prepare a people for the church above. The church here on earth is to prepare us for the eternal church above, which is the loftier worship into which there can never enter there anything that is impure. God sees the irreverent thoughts or actions, and it is registered in the books of heaven. Indeed, nothing is hidden from His all-searching eye. If you have formed any degree the habit of inattention and indifference in the house of God, exercise your God-given powers to correct that wrong attitude. Practice reverence until it becomes a part of yourself. Practice reverence until it becomes a part of yourself. Now let's turn to John chapter 1, verses 18 to 33. How many of you have found it? All right, let's proceed. It begins right away with these words. No man hath seen God at any time. The only begotten Son, which is in the bosom of the Father, He hath declared Him. Verse 19, and this is the record of John, whom the Jews sent priests and Levites from Jerusalem to ask him, who are you? Who art thou? And he confessed, that is, John confessed, and denied not. But he confessed, I am not the Christ. And they asked him, what then? Art thou Elias, or the Greek New Testament for the Hebrew Elijah? Art thou Elijah? And he said, I am not. Then art thou that prophet, referring to the Messiah? Because he was prophesied to be the prophet to come. And he answered, no. Verse 22. Then said they unto him, then who art thou, that we may give an answer to them that sent us? What sayest thou then of thyself? He said, and he's repeating the words of prophecy here. How important that we understand prophecy. It was part of our discussion this morning. We need to go back and understand prophecy, because we're always saying Jesus is coming, and He's not coming. He comes at the appointed time. And so we need to understand prophecy. He now repeats prophecy. He said, I am the voice of one crying in the wilderness. Make straight the way of the Lord, as said the prophet Isaiah. That is our work today, to prepare the way, to make straight the way of the Lord in preparation for His second and final coming. And they which were sent were of the Pharisees. These were no ordinary individuals. They were authorities. They were deputations, a deputation of the Pharisees themselves, an extension, and one who would make the proper report. And they asked him and said unto him, why baptizest thou then, if thou be not the Christ, nor Elijah, nor the prophet? Why are you baptizing, Lord? Why, by what authority? And John answered them, I'd like to point out today, we often emphasize water baptism. That's not wrong. But unless we are baptized by the early rain and the former rain, we shall never see God. That's where the emphasis on the former rain, the latter rain, as we move on to the verses here, will properly define and illustrate. John answered them, saying, I baptize you with water. That's water, physical water. But there stands one among you whom you know not. He it is who coming after me is preferred before me, whose shoes latchet I am not worthy to unloose. These things were done in Bethabar, beyond Jordan, where John was baptizing. The next day John seeth Jesus coming unto him, and I want you to underline that, because this is the message we should be proclaiming, the foundation that is. You will find that it is the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world, and the Holy Spirit, which reveals Christ and the kingdom and the truth of God. The next day, John sees Jesus coming, and saith, Behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. This is he of whom I said, After me cometh a man which is preferred before me, for he was before me. Wonderful. Okay, so John acknowledges that Jesus was in existence before his appearance. And I knew him not, but that he should be made manifest. Israel, he says, be manifest to Israel, to God's people. Therefore am I come baptizing with water. That's the purpose there. And John bare record saying, I saw the Spirit. And you can also read that in Matthew 3:16 and Mark 1:10. I saw the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove, and it abode upon him. Physical evidence. He was going to be both anointed as the Messiah and empowered to do his work through the Holy Spirit. And I knew him not, but he that sent me to baptize with water, the same said unto me, He said that to John, upon whom thou shalt see the Spirit descending and remaining. All right, this is important as we understand the baptism of the early rain and the late rain. When it is poured upon us, it should remain within us as the power. Upon whom thou shalt see the Spirit descending and remaining on him, the same is he which baptizeth with the Holy Spirit. Here's the contrast. One baptizes with water. The other is baptism by the Holy Spirit. All right. And I saw and bear record that this is the Son of God. This is indeed the Son of God. Now let's turn our Bibles to chapter 14, beginning with verse 8. Chapter 14 of the book of John. All right, so let's continue reading through this and let the Holy Spirit speak to us individually. John 14, beginning with verse 8. Have you found it? Amen. Philip saith unto him, Lord, show us the Father, and it sufficeth us, or it will satisfy us. Jesus said unto him, Have I been so long time with you, and yet hast thou not known me, Philip? He that hath seen me hath seen the Father. And how sayest thou then, Show us the Father? Believest thou not that I am in the Father, and the Father in me? The words that I speak unto you, I speak not of myself, but the Father that dwelleth in me, He doeth the works. Notice that? The works. Believe that I am in the Father and the Father in me, or else. So it is important that we understand what the role of true works are. They are part of believing in Him and a manifestation of Him residing and abiding in us. Believe me for the very works' sake. That is Jesus speaking of the existence of the invisible Father revealed through his works. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that, and that's now referring to you and me, he that believeth on me, what follows? The works that I do shall he do also. And in fact, it says greater works than these shall he do, because I go unto my Father. What does that indicate? The following. Him going to the Father will enable his people from the time of the disciples to the very end to do greater works than he did in the 3.5-year period that he was on this earth giving the mission of God. And whatsoever ye shall ask in my name, that will I do, that that Father may be glorified in the Son. If you shall ask anything in my name, I shall do it. It's a promise. If you love me, keep my commandments. And then here it is on our topic. And I will pray the Father. Jesus prayed, and we should pray for the Holy Spirit. I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another comforter that he may abide with you forever. Forever. So the outpouring and the retaining of the Holy Spirit is included in the promise forever. Even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it seeth him not, the world goes by to see is to believe. The Christian goes by faith, I believe. Even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him, but you know him. Do you? Do I? You know him, for he dwells with you and shall be in you. And much in the same way as Jacob said prior to his understanding of the presence and the holiness of God, I was in the presence of God and I knew it not. I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you yet a little while. There's a tarrying time, and the world seeth me no more, but you see me, because I live, you shall live also. At that day ye shall know that I am in my Father, and you in me, and I in you. Wow. Now look at verse 26. But the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, or the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things and bring all things to your remembrance, whatsoever I have said unto you. And I love this. I have to include this in our reading, because this is what the world cannot give to you and me. The peace that passeth understanding. Look at what's happening at this very moment, friends. They're trying to obtain peace through war. That's not God's way. That's Satan's way. I'll say it straight there. He's the father of war. Peace I leave with you, my peace. That's God's peace I give to you. Not as the world gives, give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. And so let's now turn to Matthew 3, 5 to 12. Matthew chapter 3, 5 to 12, bearing in mind the topics we're discussing this morning. So precious to our hearts. Matthew chapter 3, verses 5 to 12. But I'm going to begin with verse 1. To show you are talking about the same person who prepared the way, even as we are to prepare the way and make straight paths in order for Christ to come. That's why he isn't coming as well. We have contributed to the delay. I thank God that in God's wisdom and the plan of salvation, he placed a time where prophecy was timed. And he also placed a time where prophecy no longer had time to it. Either we can help hasten, unfortunately, to delay as well, but not beyond where God has set limits in his wisdom. In those days came John the Baptist, preaching in the wilderness of Judea. What was his message? If you read what Jesus began, it says, "Repent ye, for the kingdom of God is at hand." This was also the message of John. It says, "Repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." And this is what was spoken by Isaiah as well. "For this is he that was spoken of by prophet Isaiah, saying, the voice of one crying in the wilderness." What was his message? "Prepare ye the way of the Lord, make his paths straight." Otherwise, they are crooked. And the same John had his raiment of camel's hair and a leathern girdle about his loins, and his meat or his food was locusts and wild honey. Then went out to him, they went to him, notice that, Jerusalem and all Judea and all the region round about Jordan, and they were baptized of him in the Jordan, confessing their sins. So your water baptism is a baptism unto repentance. The work of Christ in baptizing us by the Holy Spirit is to instill in us the Spirit of Christ and to seal us in the character and the name of the Father. But when he saw many of the Pharisees and Sadducees come into his baptism, he said unto them, O generation. And we pointed this out this morning, the generation, a cursed generation. Not because they cursed themselves, but because of the work prior to them, they suffered the consequences. O generation of vipers, who hath warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Bring forth therefore fruits meet or worthy for repentance. And think not to say within yourselves, we have Abraham to our father. All two major global religions, monotheistic, that is, claim Abraham. We do too as Christians, the father of faith. But it produces a totally different generational outcome if we understand what that kind of spiritual heritage really is. Think not to say within yourselves, we have Abraham to our father, for I say unto you, look at this, friends. So it's not just tracing, if that is still possible, the heredity of our origins, literally, but spiritually, because Jesus said this so clearly to them. For I say unto you that God is able of these stones, not even human beings, stones, to raise up children unto Abraham. You know, we often think of ourselves and vaunt ourselves. If we don't remain humble, God will raise up stones to replace us. And now also the axe, strong words forthcoming, is laid to the root of the tree. Therefore, every tree which bringeth not forth good fruit is what? Hewn down and cast into the fire. I indeed baptize you with water. There are two kinds of baptism, the baptism of man through water and the baptism of the Holy Spirit through fire. I indeed baptize you with water unto repentance, but he that cometh after me is mightier than I, whose shoes I am not worthy to bear. He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with what? With fire. Whose fan is in his hand, and he will thoroughly, that's what it really is, thoroughly purge his floor and gather his wheat into the garner as the harvest, but he will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire. So are we ready for water baptism? We're trying to do that. After that, are you ready for the fiery baptism by the Holy Spirit? That you will have to answer. And your answer will be based on how much you understand of the operations of the work of the Holy Spirit in their appointed sphere of functions under the power of the gospel. You know, I was going through this. And I've been going through this many times, the study of the former rain and the latter rain. And again, it was brought with force to me even just this morning. We need to go through this again and again, because Satan doesn't want us to understand it. Because the moment we understand this, his power is broken. You see, the latter rain is given to meet the greatest crisis ever, the crisis of the ages, which we are talking about and hopefully preparing for, and we should know how to prepare for it, by the way. It's called the National Sunday Law. It will become the Global Sunday Law. It's the mark of the beast. This also will include the final persecution, because there's persecution prior to that, and the giving of the final loud cry, which is given in Revelation chapter 18. And the finishing of the work, which is promised by God. What he began, he will finish. The latter rain is more abundant and greater in extent than the former rain. Of course, the former rain is given to plant the seed. The latter rain according to the workings of the agricultural economy so familiar to the people of Israel, was for the harvest, the fixing of the harvest. The last rain will be and has to be more abundant and greater in extent. That's why you read about Jesus promising them the Holy Spirit, the outpouring of the Holy Spirit in former rain power. And then as the work of the Holy Spirit increases through the message of the first, the second, third angel's message, it swells into the loud cry. It will be worldwide in extent. That is the greater in extent because it will be worldwide. And so, will those under the latter rain have more love, faith, courage than the apostles at Pentecost? If that is the case, will that be the case? No. But under the power of the latter rain, the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, thousands all around the world will do what the apostles did. That is why Jesus said, and greater work than this shall you do. And so really, with emphasis to the latter rain, at this, in these statements that I'm going to share with you, is the greatest need of the church today. Not more organization, not more money, not more machinery, as important as they are. They don't replace or supplant the power of Christ through the Holy Spirit. Zechariah 4, verse 6. Not by might, nor by power, but by my Spirit, saith the Lord of hosts. I like that. Lord of hosts. So that's the power that he brings with me. It's a host. You can't number it. In Acts 1:8, we know this passage is what Jesus promised the disciples then and now, that you shall receive power. So if you're looking for power, this is where it comes from. After that, the Holy Ghost is come upon you. In Luke 24:49, which is a repetition really of the other promises you find in the New Testament, as Christ also gave to John, but tarry ye. So the tarrying time includes that. You have to wait for it. Prepare for it and wait for it. But tarry ye in the city of Jerusalem until, okay? Until you be endued with the power from on high. Tarry ye. What we need, therefore, all of us, is the revival of the preaching of a twofold message. And what is this twofold message? It is a twofold message that John the Baptist's message contained, and which we just read very briefly as we read those verses in the scriptures. One, it says, behold the Lamb of God which taketh away the sin of the world. John 1:29. And then as we just read, the second part of John's message was, he shall, speaking of one that was before him and came after him, baptize you with the Holy Ghost or the Holy Spirit and with fire. Again, I repeat this. It's repetitious, but it's essential for emphasis. We often talk about we need to baptize them. We better move forward. Aside from baptizing them with water and getting them listed up as members of the church, we need to emphasize the fact that they need to be baptized, as Jesus said it so plainly, emphatically. They need the baptism of the Holy Spirit. He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. Again, in the context of this short study, this is the twofold gospel for these days. The Lamb of God and the Holy Spirit of Christ. Let me say that again. The Lamb of God and the Holy Spirit. And this now comprehends the following. The blood of the Lamb, not just the Lamb, but the blood of the Lamb which taketh away the sins of this world. And the baptism of the Holy Spirit. The cleansing blood and the empowering spirit.
The justifying blood, we are justified by his blood. And the sanctification of the Spirit. The blood of the Lamb for sinners. The baptism of the Holy Spirit for the saints. First, we must be cleansed from sin. And then we must be baptized by the Holy Spirit with fire. When we are emptied of sin, we then can be filled with the Holy Spirit because they cannot mutually coexist. When we are emptied of sin, only then can we be filled with the Holy Spirit. When we have a new heart, it is because we will also have the new power that comes from the Holy Spirit. In other words, these big words that have been the source of a lot of the back and forth in Christianity on the doctrine of justification and sanctification, they come hand in hand. Justification and sanctification. Imputed righteousness and imparted righteousness. Regeneration and transformation. A babe in Christ and afterwards a full-grown man in Christ. Really, it's a new standing and a new condition. You get this, friends? As we study this topic on the necessity of the former reign and the latter reign, it is because we need to be brought to the new condition. One for the sinner and one for the saints. Those who have been rebelling against the grace and the love of God need to be brought to Christ through the blood of the Lamb. But those who have been brought to the Lamb of God and been cleansed by his blood need to be empowered to receive the righteousness of Christ. So God will reveal all our unconscious sins to us. Those things that we're conscious of or has been pointed out to us many times in very difficult situations, like we were pointing out this morning, crisis reveals character as well as it develops character depending on how we react to the crisis and understand what it is for. It develops character. Without that, character cannot be developed. That is the portion of the whole work of the Holy Spirit with fire. It hurts. But the hurting is in order to heal us, not to destroy us. That's the work of the Holy Spirit. Now, concerning this first point, let me just back up a little bit. The purposes of the early reign they're not entirely different. But by contrast and comparison, they are different from the purposes of the latter reign. And it is extremely important for everyone to clearly understand what the early reign is to lead us into. It prepares us. For what? Number one, into all truth about God and his will for us. To complete our knowledge of ourselves, our true condition, our weaknesses, our faults, our deficiencies of character, our unknown and unconscious sins, and our constant, on one hand, our constant dependence upon God. Plenty of that, isn't it? But that's the work of the former reign. Number two, this early reign is to lead us to a thorough repentance, confession, and forsaking of all our sins. Number three is to bring us to a perfect surrender of our will to God. It was pointed out earlier in one of the sermons here, surrender is one of the most difficult, if not the most difficult aspect of being saved, surrender. Of our will to God's will, to a wholehearted obedience to all that God asks of us. And number four, to gain the complete, and this is where a lot of people struggle, including myself. Is it possible? I ask, and you should, and I will. I do.
We can gain complete. That's just like the Holy Spirit. I receive it. The question is, have you still retained it? So you might have, this is to give us the complete and unbroken victory over every besetting sin. Not just that sin, but the one that constantly besets us. And you know it. That's an individual thing. In order for what? I'll tell you, it's a much higher goal. Why do we want to overcome sin? It's not just because we want to become victorious, but in order for us to fully reflect the image of Jesus fully. That's the purpose. And to become fully mature men and women in Christ Jesus, as Paul points out in his epistles. So concerning the very first point, which is all truth about God and his will for us, let us pause to remind ourselves of some of the important Bible and spirit prophecy statements which declares that the work of the Holy Spirit is to reveal all of our sins to us so that not one unknown sin remains. That is the purpose. Not to make life more difficult, but to undeceive us as to our true condition. Okay? So this is what Paul was saying when he wrote, and we sometimes see it in a different light, that's fine. This is multifaceted. Philippians 3, 14 and 15, he says, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Let us therefore, as many as be perfect, be thus minded. And if in anything ye be otherwise minded, God shall reveal even this unto you. That's what Paul meant by that. Even those unknown, he will sense, he will reveal this unto you. And Jesus said in John 16:8, and when he, the Holy Spirit, is come, he will reprove or convict the world of sin. He, the Holy Spirit, will teach you all things. John 14:26. John declared, but ye have an unction from the Holy One, and you know all things. 1 John 2:20. The work, then, of the Holy Spirit is to lead us into all truth. When he, the Spirit of truth, has come, he will guide you into all the truth. So, the Holy Spirit as a person wants to guide us and to lead us into all truth about ourselves. And will reveal to us all of our weaknesses, all of our faults, all of our shortcomings, and all that God as well would have us to know, to be, and to do. The Holy Spirit will lead us into the whole truth about ourselves just as rapidly as we are able and willing to bear that revelation. So that's why we need to surrender. As fast as we are willing and able to bear that revelation of unconscious weaknesses and faults, God will reveal more. That's what happened to a generation and generations of truth. Those who were willing to receive, received more. Those who were unwilling were left behind. You know, to glory in their own glory, not in the glory of God. Our high calling, page 152, says, it is the Spirit that convicts of sin, and with the consent of the human being, what will he do? He expels the sin from the heart. So our will, our consent, is vital to the expulsion of sins in our heart. You know, as I was going through our backyard, and you know this, those of you who do a lot of gardening, I can only do so much now, but I'm always impressed every time this familiar thing is before me and I'm engaging in this activity. I'm wondering, why is it that the weeds grow faster, grow taller, grow stronger than the good ones, the good sin? That's the nature of sin. And it grows
even between the good grass and the bad weed, which grow together. The roots of the bad weed grow deeper than that of the good seed. And so it takes more struggle, more work to get rid of it. But thank God there's all the power given by those Holy Spirit to be able to deal with all these problems that we have in our lives. The greatest problem we have is really sin. Not anything else but sin. A couple of more references and I'm going to wind this up for this morning's study. Whatever may be the nature of our defects, the Spirit of God will enable us first to discern them, and then grace. This is why it says, by grace you are saved. We don't go too far enough in discovering what grace actually means and its role. We often just say, by grace you are saved, and that's finished. But you go through all the study on the word grace, you'll find that it is the power of God to salvation. So the work of the Holy Spirit is to enable us first to discern. We cannot do anything unless we first discern it. When we discern it, then grace will be given us whereby we may overcome. I heard the word this morning, overcome. It is only through the grace of God that we can do that, not on our own efforts. That's the works of man, not the works of God. So whatever the nature of that defect, the Spirit of God will enable us. He will baptize us. That is, Christ will baptize us with the Holy Spirit and with fire. And I like what it says in Hebrews 12:29. To sin wherever found, our God is a consuming fire. The word consuming is not addressed to the sinner at that verse. It is addressed to sin. That is great. That's a great passage. It is the hope that we have that we can. You know, I get sometimes very desperate. I'm asking, Lord, will I be saved eventually? Well, on my own, not and never. But with the power of God to consume sin, as totally as he will consume, you know, at the end of this, the period of this earth's history, consume the earth and bring on a new one, is to the extent to which all our sins can be consumed if we allow the work of the Holy Spirit to do his work in us. In all who submit to his power, the Holy Spirit will consume sin. So friends, we are sinners, no doubt. But sin is not a necessity, it is a curse. We want that curse to be consumed and for the sinner to be turned into a saint. May God bless you as we continue to study these topics.
Thank you, Pastor Nat, for the message this morning. For our closing song, let's turn our hymnals to hymn number 335, What a Wonderful Savior. Hymn number 335. Please rise.
What a wonderful Savior.
unspoken requests. Let's keep our hands up high. Father in heaven, we thank you, Lord, for this short time we have had to go over scriptures, which we have failed to do in the past. And so you're giving us time to redeem us, to make up for lost time in whatever remains. What the Holy Spirit can do for us and do with us can be much more than all the lost time we have wasted. Forgive us, Lord, for this. Teach us that repentance is necessary, but sanctification is more than required of us. It is accepting the righteousness of God and being sealed in the forehead with the character, the name of the Father, which Christ revealed to us. Lord, these hands are raised because we have great needs. The greatest need of all is for us to understand that sin is hateful and God hates it. And if we continue to cling to it, he has no choice but at the end to destroy sin and those that are still hanging on to it when we should have let go of it a long time before. Forgive us, Lord. Soften our hearts. It's been hardened by sin. That's what sin does. It hardens us. Give us a heart of flesh, the flesh that was in Christ. In Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
Thank you.